Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill O'Brien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to a new week here at the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today is it's the middle of October. Today is the 15th day of October in the year 2018, and it is a pleasure to be with you once again on this, our first day of broadcasting this week. I trust that if everything goes well, we'll be able to get in a full week. I do hope so. We did, you go in every week with that note of optimism, and then things don't quite turn out that way. Well, at least your intentions were good. So right now, as I can say on this Monday, our intentions are good. So everything works out. We'll be together a couple of more times this week as well as today. I do hope that you had a wonderful weekend, and I again want to mention how tremendous it is to have an opportunity to be with you and share some thinking on what I think are some pretty important and pretty interesting things. As I usually do, I would like to welcome you to participate in our program more actively by getting on the phone and sharing some of your thoughts or concerns or fears or hopes or whatever they might be with us. I know that I would appreciate it, and I know our other listeners would appreciate it as well. We have a couple of phone lines that will get you directly into the Head On Radio Network studios. And if you do use these phone lines and call in, Agnes is there in the studio today, along with Bob. Bob did the intro to the program, and I believe Agnes is going to do the production of the program from here on. She will get you on the air immediately if you choose to do that. The phone numbers are both of them same area code 304. The first one is 304-574-8178. That's 304-574-8178. And the new number is area code 304-640-2829. That's 640-2829. If you're a little bit uncomfortable or for whatever reason unwilling to go on the air, and yet you'd like to share your thoughts with us, you can do that by communicating directly with me in one of two ways. You can either send me an email and share your thoughts that way, or you can go to our Facebook page, hit the comment button with one of the postings, and communicate directly with me that way. My email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906@gmail.com. Our Facebook page, all you need to do is go to the homepage of Facebook, which is facebook.com. And in the search box at the top, just type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution. You'll be onto our Facebook page, and you'll see a number of postings there. And if you just pick any one of those, there are two buttons or two links associated with each posting, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share link, it sends that posting to everybody on your friend list for your Facebook page. So in a sense, it gives our program kind of a wider audience, as it were. But if you'd like to comment on that posting or any other thing for that matter, just click on the comment button with any of the postings. I'll get a notice immediately from Facebook that there is a comment to one of the postings, and then I'll be able to get your thoughts directly that way. So again, the purpose is to try to encourage you to participate in the program so that we can begin some sort of a back and forth dialogue, as it were. With that, I guess the way to get into the program today, as we do almost every day, is to deal with some of the leading events of the day, kind of a news update, you might say. And I wanted to make a couple of comments because, like many of you, I saw the significant part. I didn't see the whole thing, but I saw significant portions of the, I'll tell you why in a moment. I saw significant portions of the interview on 60 Minutes last night with President Trump and Leslie Stahl, and specific reactions to that. And I was particularly struck by the president's statements about North Korea, about Kim Jong-un. Kim Jong-il is his grandfather. He was the first one. But anyway, the fact that, you know, that they're in love, according to the president. And she raised questions about the human rights record that North Korea seems to bring to the world, and raise questions about whether, in fact, you could be in love with anybody like that. And the president's comments were that they have established a relationship which has kind of cooled things down, if you will, in terms of some sort of a nuclear strike or nuclear threat from North Korea. And as the president said, the fact that things don't seem to be as volatile and as dangerous as they were is significant. And I actually do believe that, being realistic, all of us need to recognize that. On the other hand, we have the real situation going on in Saudi Arabia with the apparent execution of Washington Post journalist Jamal Khashoggi. And although Saudi Arabia continues to deny it, the fact of the matter is the Turkish government has claims to have audios and videos of what happened inside the Saudi embassy. The fact that he went into the Saudi embassy and apparently never came out seems to suggest that one must lay accountability on the door of Saudi Arabia. There's no question. It was their embassy, their security, all of it, it seems to me. I did note in today's New York Times the story that our Secretary of State Pompeo is on his way to Saudi Arabia to get the full story, to see if he can get at the real story. And as the president said, if we find that these stories of execution are true, then there's going to be severe punishment. Now, what that might be, obviously, it creates a very tense situation with a very important ally, given where they are, as well as what they do, which is produce oil. So I think, if tensions are a little bit reduced in the Far East, they certainly aren't in the Middle East. So, again, I think that we really have to pay close attention to what's going on there. The other thing that I'd like to deal with, and actually this is pretty much going to fold into a little bit of what I'd like, it's some of the things I'd like to address on today's program. And that's the president's continued role in dividing the nation even more than it's already divided. We've talked in the past about tribalism. I think it's very interesting. I watch MSNBC pretty regularly, as I think many of you know. And one of the hosts on MSNBC, Michael Kornacki, has a book out called Red and Blue about the 1990s and the rise of what he calls tribalism in American politics. And, of course, he's the guy that they bring on during the elections because he does the analysis and the counting of votes and which counties seem to be leaning towards which candidate and those kinds of things. And I don't think there's anybody better at that. I've never seen anybody better than that. He actually makes predicting elections interesting, at least to me. And given the fact that I'm sort of a junkie, maybe that's not an accurate barometer of a good host. But I do find that he has a skill, a knack. And I think NBC recognizes it because he appears on a number of others of their programs to do the same thing, which is to deal with election maps and predictions and various other things. And there's no question that he really knows this subject. And he's very good at it, and he makes it very, very interesting. But he's been talking about tribalism. Of course, the issue of tribalism is, of course, division. And it's based on the idea that we've gone well beyond partisanship. It seems to me we went from the divisions that are normal but in a two-party system, recognizing, of course, that in each of the two major parties, there were always those who were kind of in the middle, moderates, moderate Republicans, conservative Democrats, if you will. And so which way elections went oftentimes was determined by which party could pull the moderates or the conservatives in conservative Democrats, as it were, into their particular party for that election. But one of the things that has happened, of course, is that these moderates in the Republican Party have somewhat disappeared. And part of it is because of the us and they, good guys, bad guys, nature of our two-party system. In other words, we have gone beyond partisanship to extreme partisanship, and even beyond that to what, for lack of a better term, everyone's calling tribalism. And what characterizes tribalism is that it's take no prisoners. Traditionally, in our two-party politics, we were operating on the assumption that when the particular election was over, things would kind of return to normal. Moderate Republicans would go back to Republican and conservative Democrats would go back to Democrats, and everything would pretty much remain that way until it started to gear up for the next election. This tribalism situation makes things quite a bit different because there's no going back. What is happening is one side is out to obliterate the other. Politics has become what they call, for lack of a better term, I keep using that phrase, lack of a better term, all the time. But I do think, I mean, it's popular usage, but on the other hand, you could call it something else. This is take no prisoners politics, maybe. Because it's based on the idea that the other side are not just opponents, they're enemies, and that they threaten the nation. In other words, they not only provide an alternative to what we're standing for, a legitimate alternative based on the principle that in a Republican system like ours, based on mass participation, the fact that there are alternatives, that there is choice, is important. Ultimately, the ultimate goal in a tribalism situation is to eliminate the choice by obliterating the opposition, whichever side that happens to be. So what we see is a move left on the part of the Republicans and a move further right on the part a move left on the part of Democrats, where the influence of progressives becomes increasingly significant within the Democratic Party, and a move further to the right on the part of the Republican Party. And what that means is, as both parties begin to separate even more and drift toward the extremes, the compromise, the ability to work together that we used to see in our politics is rapidly disappearing. And what makes tribalism particularly dangerous is that that's what its ultimate goal is to obliterate the opposition. Once you obliterate the opposition, you remove the possibility of choice, of alternatives. There's only one choice. And what I'm suggesting is that creates authoritarianism. And that's what many people are seeing in our politics, and it frightens them. What Kornacki's book does is trace the origins of this into the 1990s. And it focuses a lot of attention on Newt Gingrich, when Newt Gingrich was Speaker of the House in the 90s, when the Republicans took control of the House of Representatives. And Newt Gingrich orchestrated what was called, for those of you who can remember, the Contract with America. And that increasingly began the process, which has continued to become more and more extreme, to the point that now we've reached what the experts refer to as the tribalism stage. And it's reflected more and more and more in the comments and the behavior of the president. Traditionally, we assume that the president, once he's elected, is the president of everybody, not only the party, those that voted for him, but those that opposed him as well. And one of the things we've been able to comment on since the campaign a couple of years ago for the elections of 2016 is that what makes President Trump different, as it were, is that he really believes and acts in consistent with his belief that he is the party of those who support him. And instead of being the party or the leader, the president of his opponents, he has made his ultimate objective to destroy his opponents. And that's what's so out of whack with America's political, the nation's political traditions. And I would suggest to you, it raises serious questions about the very survival of republicanism itself. And I don't mean republicanism with a capital R. What I mean is the republic, the ability of a two-party system to function as it was intended and designed to function. I think I'm concerned that that seems to be where things are headed. And one would think that it would be the responsibility of the President of the United States to recognize that danger and address it, rather than continue to feed into it. Unfortunately, that's what the president is doing. And it was evident, it's been evident. It was evident last week because, if you recall, in the last week, the president has attended rallies in three different places. He's becoming very, very visible with the midterm elections only 3 weeks from tomorrow. And he has promised to visit the states and support Republicans in states and in congressional districts within states that seem to have a reasonable chance of victory. And what's becoming very, very uncomfortable for Republicans, it appears in some cases, is that the president's comments and personality and the way he's treated opponents has turned off enough people that many people see it as fueling what they predict in the midterms will be a blue wave. The president has countered that by predicting his own red wave. And he's promised to get out on the campaign trail and do what he can do to make that red wave a reality. But in fact, there are some local Republicans who really are not that favorable towards a visit from the president. In other words, they're trying to run away from the president, not with him. They're not pledging total support to him and his agenda and his wall. Some are, some aren't. And one of the things that became very clear toward the end of the week last week were reports coming out of the Republican Party that the Republican National Committee had made the decision to cut bait on a number of races where it looked like the Republican candidate really didn't have a chance, where the Democratic candidate was running so far ahead in the polls that the party, the Republican Party, made the determination to not put any more money into that particular race, but to spend the money in the races which are close, where Republicans really have a chance. And of course, we're not getting as much of this as we'd like, because obviously Republicans are not comfortable or interested in making their laundry public. But the fact of the matter is, and we know, and the media occasionally points it out, that there are certain Republican districts and certain Republican candidates that don't welcome a visit from the president for fear that the president getting too close will hurt them rather than help them. Because there's no question, this president is very, very extreme. And what I mean is, those who like him love him, and those that don't like him hate him. And that becomes very difficult when you're out there trying to get votes and you're in a close race and you're trying to get every vote you can, even the ones that are in the middle, the toss-up votes, the independents. And if that's the situation you're in as a candidate, as a Republican candidate, the last thing you want is a visit from the president who's dividing and creating the political problem in the first place. So I think that's one of the things that I think all of us need to be aware of. There are a couple of other things related to this that I'd like to spend a moment or two addressing. One of them is the media. Not just the press. It used to be when we would say the media, we were talking about newspapers and journalists. Now when we use the media, we're talking about television and cable and the networks and all of that. But the fact of the matter is, at his rallies, the president goes out of his way to attack the media, as no president has ever done before. Presidents in the past have had problems with the media for understandable reasons. The media's job is to uncover news that the administration doesn't want uncovered. Because ultimately the value, the need for a free press in a political system like ours is to dig up the news that is important for voters to know in order to become informed enough to vote intelligently. The job of the media is to dig up the dirt. And the dirt, obviously, for the most part, relates to the party in power. So by definition, past presidents, past administrations have had trouble with the media, problems with the media. Richard Nixon did. Every administration does. But on the other hand, most presidents, most political leaders in the past have recognized that a free press is an important part of what makes our political system work. Because without that media, you can't have an informed electorate. And without an electorate being informed and getting access to information that those in power don't want you to get access to, our political system, as it was designed to function, can't function. This president has taken on the media like no administration, no president in the past, it seems to me. He calls the media the enemy of the people. At his rallies, he makes it a point to embarrass particular journalists who have taken positions against him and what he stands for. He had, on more than one case during these rallies, he singled out CNN. He singled out by name particular reporters at CNN or political hosts on CNN. Lemon, for example. And he finger points his finger at the media in the rallies and whips up the crowd against the media to the point that they start to chant lock her up and all these other lock him up and all these other things. I've been thinking about that. And I think I've commented on it before on this particular program. How dangerous it is. But again, it's dangerous not necessarily because it's going to destroy the media. What it's going to do is destroy people's faith in the media, people's trust in the media. Basically, the realistic objective of attacking the media is not to destroy the free press. It's not that simple. But it's to so weaken the credibility of the media, the press, that people no longer put their faith in it. People no longer trust it. They no longer trust what it says. And this is the important thing. When that trust in the media is gone, when people or significant numbers of people are inclined to not believe what they hear or not believe what they read because they believe the whole media is corrupt, that all journalists are corrupt, what that means is that what the media has to say, the dirt that it digs up, as it were, has no impact on the electorate. When people no longer trust the media, they don't hear it, or they don't see it, or they don't read it. They don't know what it is that the media is reporting, because they believe that everything the media reports is fake news, which is one of the president's favorite terms. Now, if you continue to use expressions like fake news and enemy of the people against the media, you're not going to cause the media to go away. What you're going to do is cost the media its audience. And when the media loses its audience, our political system cannot function as it was designed to function, because it's the media that digs up the information that the electorate needs in order to become an informed electorate. It can't be informed if it doesn't hear or doesn't read or doesn't see what the media has to say. It's got to basically have faith in the media in order for the media to fulfill its legitimate role in this republic. And that's what's at risk, is the people's trust, the people's faith in the objectivity of the media. I believe it's very significant, because it's the media that's going to tell us what the administration doesn't want us to know. And if you don't hear the media, or you don't read the media, you don't listen or read what's going on, then what it is you don't know is what it is that you need in order to vote intelligently. By definition, you're left with nothing but believing what the administration tells you. Because the source of the other side is gone. That's the end game in this attack on the media. That's what's at risk. And I do believe that's what all of us need to be very, very careful of. People have referred to the media, to the press, as the fourth branch of government, because it's that vital, that critical to the operation of our election system, of our electoral system. It's vital to digging up the kind of information that the electorate needs in order to become informed. Without it, you're dealing with an uninformed media. Or worse, you're dealing with a misinformed media. We're dealing with, and I think the media, Washington Post especially, has made this very clear. We're dealing with a president who has made a career out of lying. The estimates are that in the months that this president has been in office, the media has documented more than 5,000 cases where what the president says is proven to be untrue or only partially true. We're dealing with a president who tells us what he wants us to hear, what he wants us to believe. He's not telling us what we need to know. That's what the media is doing. And by attacking the media as severely and as frequently as this president does, he is weakening the credibility of the media. In other words, he's making it more and more likely that fewer and fewer people will trust what they read and trust what they hear, which plays directly into the hands of the administration. It's very, very important that we call this out for what it is, because it threatens this very security of this nation, because it threatens the citizens of this nation with having access to what they need to know in order to be informed, in order to hold their government, their elected officials accountable. I really believe that that's incredibly important. Very, very important. There's one other issue related to this. It's a facet of the same thing. but it's a stand on its own thing. And that this returns more or less to the idea of tribalism. The idea that those who disagree with you, the other side, the other party, in this case Democrats, constitute a mob. How many times in the last several weeks, have we heard Democrats referred to as a mob? How many times during the Kavanaugh hearings did we hear Chuck Grassley and Mitch McConnell make reference to the Democrats protesting the appointment of Brett Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court as being part of a mob, the mob filling our offices, filling the hallways of Congress, or filling the hallways of the Russell Senate office building where the Brett Kavanaugh hearings were being held? Those who are screaming at Republican members of the Judiciary Committee, who up and down, straight party, are supporting the nomination of Brett Kavanaugh for the Supreme Court, referring to them as a mob. References to the fact that those women, many of them abused women who in their past, who have come forward to tell their stories, the Me Too movement, reflect a mob, which is no different than the mob which hit the streets and protested the Vietnam War and blew up buildings and conducted virtual underground guerrilla warfare against law and order in this country. This kind of behavior, this kind of rhetoric, flies in the face of the ability of our two parties to continue to work together to address problems in a what is called a bipartisan point of view or a bipartisan way. We've reached the point where when a particular piece of legislation is co-sponsored by both Republicans and Democrats, in other words, when it's bipartisan, it makes news. It wasn't that long ago that business as usual was bipartisan. It was when it wasn't, when people voted the straight party line, that made news because it threatened bipartisanship. Now, bipartisanship is, we've gone well beyond it being threatened to being endangered, to the point that when something is done in a bipartisan way, it makes the press, it makes the newspapers, it makes the news at night. When a law is passed overwhelmingly because members of both parties support it, it's headline news. When in fact, that's absolutely necessary for our political system to continue to work, which indicates that most of the time, our two-party system is not working the way it was designed to work. And that ties directly into the idea of tribalism, it seems to me. what I would really planning to spend today's program on, the major issue that I'd like to address. And I'm guessing that it'll go beyond today. It'll probably go into, we'll probably be going into this for a few days. It's based on a book that I got into this past 3 or 4 days. I'm not quite, I'm more than a third of the way through it. I'm not quite halfway through it, but I'm more than a third of the way through it. And let me explain why I'm not further along in this book. Because I found it to be so relevant and so important and significant to what we're about here at the Virtual Center, that instead of going forward and being at a point where I'm two-thirds of the way through the book rather than one-third of the way through the book, I chose to go back and reread the first third for a second time. And in fact, even a third time. Because I believe what it says is that important and that significant. And with that, let me kind of give you an overview of the book I'm talking about. It's a book that was published in 1999. 20 years ago, 19 years ago. Well, 8 to be technical, 18 years ago. This is still 2018, although we're getting toward the end of it. Technically speaking, 18 years. It's by Gary Wills. And we spent time with Gary Wills before. If you remember, we dealt with Gary Wills' book on the Declaration of Independence called Inventing America. And then we spent time on the Constitution, on the Federalist Papers, with his book entitled Explaining America, which focuses principally on the Federalist Papers. On both of those, over the last couple of years, we spent significant time. I have had his book, Gary Wills' book, A Necessary Evil, it's called, on my bookshelves for a couple of years. But I'm almost embarrassed to say that a few times I started to read it, but I never really got very far. And part of the reason was I wasn't sure that it pertained directly to our program. And my focus for the last couple of years has been to concentrate on materials and focus my reading on materials that seem to offer promise to enrich our programs here at the Virtual Center. My job, at least the job that I assumed I had for so long, was to try to get into and explain as best I could what our government seemed to be about. What Gary Wills' book, A Necessary Evil, is about is the anti-government feeling that runs through the nation's history. That, in a sense, is based on the assumption that government efficiency, a government that really governs and governs effectively and efficiently, threatens human freedom, threatens individual freedom. This is a point that we've made here over and over and over again. And that is that there's a pervasive assumption throughout our history that effective, efficient government on the one hand and individual freedom on the other are contradictory to each other, are inconsistent. The more efficient and effective government functions, the bigger danger it becomes to individual freedom. In fact, the end game of that assumption is that if you didn't have any government at all, people's freedom would be total. Gary Wills quotes that in his introduction. When he opens his book in the introduction with a quote from Thoreau, Henry David Thoreau, which of course we usually think of because of his book Walden, his return to nature, and his efforts to try to separate himself from organized society on the assumption that the only way that man could receive could reach his real potential is to separate himself from society and its institutions. Many people are also familiar with Thoreau's essay on civil disobedience, which is his criticism of the Constitution of the United States because it endorses, or at least validates, the institution of slavery. And Thoreau's essay on civil disobedience is driven by his refusal to pay taxes to support a government, a constitution, which he believes is aiding and abetting an inhuman institution, which is slavery. The quote that I'm talking about from Thoreau is as follows. Thoreau writes, "I heartily accept the motto, that government is best which governs least," which most people associate, of course, with Thomas Jefferson. Thoreau says, "I heartily accept this motto, that government is best which governs least. And I should like to see it acted up to more rapidly and systematically. Carried out," Thoreau says, "it finally amounts to this, which I also believe, that government is best which governs not at all," unquote. That's the opening of Wills's book entitled A Necessary Evil, subtitled A History of American Distrust of Government. It's not that I've struggled with the book and put it down because I couldn't do it, but the couple of times that I did begin to get into this book by Gary Wills, I was dissuaded because of the title, A History of American Distrust of Government. That's something that I've made mention of several times here on the program, and I felt that I had already covered it, and I really didn't need to spend a lot of time on why Americans don't trust government. What I needed to spend most of my time on was focusing on what the founders believe that government should accomplish and how they should accomplish it, what they should do and how government should do it. And that's been my focus. This week that all changed over the last 4 or 5 days. because I began to get into this book. And I began to see the relevance of this book to much of what we're seeing going on in the world and in the nation today. And once I began to make the connections between the book and contemporary affairs, I began to get deeper into the book. And once I did, I realized I had had a gold mine. I had literally discovered gold. I want to recommend this book. I want to recommend Gary Wills, because I believe his books on the Declaration of Independence and on the Federalist Papers are two of the finest pieces of analytical writing and thinking I've read in a long time. That's what caused me, after last week's programs ended on Wednesday, Thursday or Friday, to pull this book off my bookshelf by Gary Wills. And I immediately thought, well, I've got 4 days, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, before we have to do another program again. Before I start to put together programs for next week, I'm going to give Gary Wills' book one more read, one more try. Because I know from the books that I have read by Gary Wills that they're worth reading. Gary Wills is worth reading because he's got a lot to say. It's really interesting. My wife is out of town. She'll be out of town until the end of this week. And she left last Thursday, the day after we did our last program together. So basically, I was looking at 8 or 9 days by myself. And I thought, well, this is going to give me an opportunity to do some reading, to look at some stuff that I really hadn't had time to look at before. And the first thing I put my hands on was this book by Gary Wills. It's really interesting. I've been on the phone 2 or 3 times a day with my wife, obviously. She's babysitting grandchildren in New England. She asked me on Saturday what I was doing. And I said, I'm reading this book that I've had on my bookshelf for several years but didn't read. I said, it's wonderful. I can't believe how much I'm loving it. It's one of the best things I've read in a long time. And her response was, well, only you could say something like that. I thought you'd be missing me, and here you are talking about the wonderful time you're having without me. And I said, no, I didn't mean it that way. But what your being gone did was provide me with time, with an opportunity. And I happened to fall into something that I found extremely rewarding. And as I told her, there it's going to be, hopefully, something that benefits our listeners here at the Virtual Center as well. That's the issue. And it seems to me, this distrust of government, let me just use this and get into this for a few moments. We've got about 5 or 6 minutes left in this, our first hour. So we can start to get into the content of Gary Wills' contribution in our second hour. But let me spend the rest of the remaining minutes in this hour talking about the idea of America's distrust of government. And let me relate it specifically to what we were just talking about earlier in this hour. And that is the president's inclination over the last couple of weeks to refer to his opponents, the Democrats, as being a mob. In effect, that exactly typifies or reflects what Gary Wills is writing about. What the president is doing in referring to his opponents as representing or reflecting a mob is attacking the credibility of his opposition. And he's playing to the fact that those people who support him, those who turn out at his rallies, those most responsible for electing him, that's exactly what he wants them to believe, is that his opponents are enemies. They threaten the country. And referring to them as a mob is the epitome of that. He's not going to eliminate his opponents. What he's going to do is weaken the credibility of his opponents. If he does it, if he refers to them as a mob loudly enough and often enough, he's going to convince many people, not all, but many people, that indeed those who don't go along with President Trump, those who don't support the idea of a wall, constitute membership in a mob. And a mob threatens the peace and security of a nation. A mob is the violent physical manifestation of revolution, of radicalism. What that means is you are changing the very nature of bipartisanship in our republic, because you are attacking the credibility of your opponents. You're attacking their patriotism. You're attacking their right to exist. And when you do that, you're obviously attacking the credibility of what they have to say. When you refer to them as a mob, you are in fact infringing on the credibility of what that mob stands for, what they say. In other words, you are attacking the positions, the agenda of your opponents by associating the positions they advocate as being the positions of a mob, of a group committed to violence. That's not unintentional. Because if you look back through our history, you will find that our history, much of it, is comprised of something we might call the mob, the masses. Because throughout our history, those in power, not just politically, but economically and socially and culturally as well, those who have made it, those whose positions are secure, those with good jobs and healthy incomes, those with a future that they don't really have to worry about, those who can afford to send their kids to Ivy League schools. In other words, who can guarantee their kids and thereby their kids' kids that they'll be able to inherit the same positions of advantage that they have. They have traditionally looked upon their opponents as members of a mob. This morning in class, we were talking about the Constitutional Convention opening in May 1787. And the point that I was making, of course, and I've made it here more than once, is that in September of 1786, the Nationalists, Madison, Hamilton, and those who supported them, were responsible for the calling of a convention to meet in Annapolis, Maryland, to discuss commerce throughout the nation. And as we've reported on this program before, even though all states were encouraged to send delegates to Annapolis, when the Annapolis Convention opened, only the delegates from five states were there. And our history books have looked upon this as failure, but have credited Alexander Hamilton with snatching success from failure by putting out the call for the Constitutional Convention in May of the next year in Philadelphia to consider revising the Articles of Confederation and addressing the other exigencies of the nation. And as we've pointed out more than once, 12 states showed up at Philadelphia. Rhode Island did not send delegates to Philadelphia, but every other state did. So the question is, why did only five states show up at Annapolis, while 12 showed up in Philadelphia? Nine months later. And it's difficult to explain that in any other way than to point to Shays' Rebellion in Western Massachusetts, which broke out in late September of 1786 and extended through into and toward the end of October 1786. Western Massachusetts seemed to be an open civil war. The farmers and the poorest people in the western part of this state, whose property was being taken away for non-payment of taxes, took matters into their own hands, stormed the armory in Springfield, armed themselves, and began to march throughout the western part of the state, closing down courts so that these courts could no longer foreclose on other poor citizens who could not pay their debts or their taxes. The Nationalists seized upon this. And as I told my class this morning, if you read the newspapers in Richmond, Virginia, in New York, in Philadelphia, in Baltimore, you would swear that the end of the world, Armageddon itself, was beginning in Western Massachusetts. What was going on was the beginning of the end. Because most prominent people realized that the same kinds of economic circumstances which gave rise to Shays Rebellion in Massachusetts existed in many of the other states. Many of the other states experienced the same kind of internal conflict, violence, that Massachusetts did, not just to that extreme, to that level. The newspapers played it up throughout the country and made Shays Rebellion look much worse than it actually was. Because they knew that reputable people throughout the country were afraid of and distrusted mob violence. The mob. Throughout our history, the mob, the threat of the masses rising up against the power structure, was a constant theme throughout the nation's history. And those in power have always resorted to the threat of the mob in order to whip up reputable people against the threat and the danger of mass violence. And that's exactly the same thing as President Trump is doing right now. Basically, he is suggesting that Brett Kavanaugh, not Christine Blasey Ford, was the victim. Brett Kavanaugh should and his family should never have been put through the humiliation that they experienced in order to try to get him a legitimate seat on the Supreme Court of the United States. That this is an example of an out-of-control mob. The fact of the matter is, the threat of the mob has always been a way to paint those trying to help themselves in this society. What throughout our history has been happening, of course, is that certain people are always left on the outside looking in. What Gary Wills talks about in his book, A Necessary Evil, is the history of distrust in government throughout our nation's development. The efforts of those on top to suggest that a government that can function is a government that threatens individual freedom. And the idea that while many of us are poor, and some of us have been very fortunate, it's individual freedom that is necessary for everybody to have the chance to be successful. And so the implication is, if government becomes too efficient, it threatens individual freedom. And when it threatens individual freedom, it threatens the ability of the individual to hit the jackpot. And ultimately, what you're doing is driving the most desperate. You're painting them into the corner and corner and labeling them as a mob. It's a rhetorical device to control people. It's been used throughout our history, and it's still being used. And I realize I've gone over. We're 10 minutes into our second hour, and I apologize for that, but we're really not. So let's pause, even though we are a little bit late. Let's pause for a couple of minutes. Just give me a chance to kind of get a second blow, as it were, and give you a chance to get up and walk around and get a cold drink or whatever. And then we'll continue. You're listening to the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. We're going to pause for a brief break, and then we'll be right back and we'll continue this topic. This is really an important one. I'm kind of excited about this. I hope that excitement is coming across to you. Please stay with us. We'll be right back.
We now return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Thank you, Agnes, and welcome to our second hour here in the Virtual Center. It's 14 minutes after the hour, so granted, it's kind of an abbreviated hour. It's actually 45 minutes, but be that as it may, I needed a few minutes anyway to kind of just relax a little bit and kind of collect my thoughts and various other things, because I'll be honest, I don't want to blow this. This is too good. I mean, what I mean is it's too important. And to not give this the credit that it is due would be a disservice to the Virtual Center and to what I believe in, because the reason I want to be on is to be able to point things like this out and hopefully and defend them and make the case that they're really important, because I really do believe they are. If you would like to participate in this issue, this is an important one, and I know most of you have something to contribute to this. We would love to hear from you. If you pick up the phone and call one of the two phone lines that we've got, we'll get you directly into our studios, and Agnes will get you on the air pronto, if you'd like. The two numbers are area code 304-574-8178 and 304-640-2829. That's 574-8178, 640-2829. Both of them, area code 304. Or, if you'd like to communicate your thoughts directly with me, you can send me an email. My email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. Or you can reach me directly by going onto our Facebook page. And after one of the postings on that Facebook page, if you click on the comment button, you can make your comment about that posting or about the program, about the issue we're discussing. The point is, we want to make sure that we're able to hear from you, because if you've got something to say, we want to hear it. We want to know what that is. And so therefore, you can call directly into the program and share your thoughts with us directly, or you can send them to me and trust me to share them with our audience for you. The most important thing is that the issues that you would like to raise get to the people who are listening, who are participating in this program with you, because that's the way we all learn, and I include myself in that group. We were talking about Gary Wills' book, A Necessary Evil, A History of American Distrust of Government. And basically, I was relating this book and the theme of this book, the distrust, American distrust of government, to the president's efforts, A, to attack the media as the enemy of the people, and B, to attack Democrats as reflective or part of what he refers to as a mob. And my point is that it's important to focus on this idea of the mob and be very clear on what it means to us. When we hear the word mob, we become concerned. We become frightened. It's not the kind of a word that makes you feel content, that makes you feel comfortable. It's the kind of a word that makes you feel uneasy. It has negative connotations. And when you paint your opponents with one brush, that labeled the mob, then what you're doing is suggesting that they really are the enemy of the people. They're not only our enemies as Republicans, as supporters of Donald Trump, they're the nation's enemies, because they're part of a mob. And their access to the media is making the media an enemy of the people. The implication is the only way to silence the mob and the only way to bring back credibility to the media is to support me, support the Republican agenda, support the Republican Party, support its President Donald Trump. because Donald Trump was elected president because he speaks for the people, for the forgotten people, for the people that are being overlooked or ignored by the establishment. Hillary was part of the establishment. She got millions from Wall Street, from large financial institutions, from big money around the world through the Clinton Foundation. In other words, Hillary was a spokesman for them. I am the spokesman for you, the people, the forgotten people, the ignored people, the taken advantage of people, the victims. You are a victim because the establishment doesn't care about you. They take you for granted. They want your support at election time, but they never do anything to help you, to listen to you, to pay serious attention to your concerns and your fears. I will. I guess the word that best defines that from the president's perspective is to refer to himself as the people's president. So I'm your voice. In one rally, as I recall, the president actually said that. I am the voice of the forgotten, the voice of the people. So it's us versus them. Them are the liberals, the media, the mob. Not only are they enemies to the nation and to us, but their agenda is as well. What they advocate, like the God-awful Affordable Care Act, what we promise is more health care that's cheaper. Tax cuts. Everything we can do to weaken government, because to weaken government expands freedom. We are the party that supports your freedom. And freedom in this society is the ticket to opportunity. Government threatens that. Efficient government threatens that. Why do you think that the founders built a system based on separation of powers and checks and balances? Because the purpose of a checks and balances system is to render government unable to govern in order to defend the freedom of people, protect the individual freedom of people. That's the rhetoric, that's the story, that's the theme. That's what Gary Wills is writing his book about. A history of American distrust of government. The fact of the matter is, when you weaken government, when you disarm it, when you starve it, when you starve the beast, as it were. You force government to cut back on the programs that interfere and jeopardize and threaten people's freedom. But the key is, whose freedom is most threatened by an effective, efficient government? Whose behavior is being regulated by government? Whose freedom is most being expanded when you disarm or reduce government's budget to the point that they can no longer operate? The people at the top. The president's tax cut, tens of billions of dollars, projected in 10 years to exceed $500 billion in tax cuts, more than 80% of it going to the 1%, to the few. Government is currently, the reports are coming out now, government is running a deficit way ahead of schedule. The impact of the tax cuts is happening faster on government than it was initially projected to be. It was projected to take better than a year, a couple of years, to reach the $500 billion point in the government's deficit. Now it's becoming clear that we're going to reach that sooner. What that means is, in order to continue to function, in order for government agencies to continue to function, they're going to have to find a way to get them get their hands on some revenue. The tax cuts for corporations were made permanent. The tax cuts for individual citizens are temporary, which means that eventually government's going to come back into your bank account with a vengeance, because it's going to be so desperate for revenue. In the interim, Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security are government's most likely way to get its hands on some money, your money. Not our money, because our tax cuts were passed to be permanent. We are permanently shielded from government. You are not. So the attack on government as being the promotion for individual freedom is not totally a myth. Freedom is being expanded. The freedom of those most threatened by an efficient, effective government, because an efficient, effective government regulates. An efficient, effective government serves people. At the end of the first hour, I made reference to an event in Western Massachusetts called Shays' Rebellion in 1786. And the reason Shays' Rebellion is so significant in our history is because it drives the states to send delegates to Philadelphia to revise the Articles. Because it kind of suggests that the nation is always under the threat of the potential mob, unless there's a government strong enough to address the threat of the mob. And so the argument is, what people feared when they stayed away from Annapolis is what drove these same states to send their delegates to Philadelphia in 1787. Gary Wills, in the very first chapter of his book, A Necessary Evil, makes the point that the real victims, I'm reading this, this is a quote from page 21 of Gary Wills' introduction. And this is what he said: the real victims of our fear of government are not those faced with such extreme action, not even those threatened by the so-called mob. The real victims are the millions of poor or shelterless or medically indigent who've been told over and over again over the years that they must lack medical care or life support in the name of their very own freedom. Better for them to starve than to be enslaved by big government. That's the real cost of our anti-government values. What these people are doing is weakening our trust of government and what government does. Because when government governs in the public interest, it is fulfilling its responsibilities to promote the general welfare of all the people, not just the few. But when government is weakened, when government is starved, when government cannot regulate and cannot deliver the services that people need, who suffers? The poor. Those who need subsidies in order to find housing. Those who need subsidies in order to put nutritious meals on the table. Those dependent on subsidies to gain access to meaningful health care. When government can't provide those services, they are the ones that suffer. Who benefits? Those who would be regulated by an efficient government, who now are set free because government cannot effectively regulate when it doesn't have the personality or the staff to regulate effectively. We've seen, for example, reports that the personnel that work for the Internal Revenue Service, IRS, have been so decimated, the staff is so small, that the number of audits, income tax audits, that IRS can initiate are way down. Who are the people most threatened by government audits? Not the poorest Americans, the wealthiest Americans. Why don't we know what President Trump's private business interests are all about? Why haven't we been given access to his taxes? as other presidents have given us. His reason? Because I'm being audited. The way you deal with that, the threat of an audit, is to so dismantle government that it can't perform them. And therefore, you are free to conduct business as usual. What Gary Wills is implying in his history of America's distrust of government is that those in power, those most threatened by an effective government, are the ones responsible for planting the distrust of government in the minds of the American people. Be aware that we will always have government. It's not going away. In spite of what Thoreau tells us, we're never going to reach the point where government doesn't govern at all. Because when you reach that point, society disintegrates. You don't even have a society anymore. It's not nirvana. It's the exact opposite of nirvana. Individual freedom is not enhanced. It's destroyed. What we're talking about here is rhetorical propaganda to the nth degree, the most important, significant propaganda that a nation, a government, or a people can participate in. The most vulnerable of our citizens are the ones who pay the price. The best off among our citizens are the ones who reap the benefits. And I think we'll see that if we but look. Because the media is giving us the information which is enabling us to look. But the administration is engaged in a heated campaign to discourage people from looking by suggesting that all those people who aren't with us, who aren't voting for us, are part of a mob. And that's what we're dealing with. We don't have that much time left in our program, a little bit more than 20 minutes. But I want to share with you from Gary Wills' book. A comparative list of the characteristics or the qualities of values associated with this anti-government campaign. In other words, if you're going to turn people against government regulation, against government efficiency, against government effectiveness, if you want to disarm government, what do you have to do to make it work? What do you have to believe in order to become a believer that government is a danger rather than an asset? Here is a list of characteristics or values that Gary Wills provides on this anti-government sentiment that we've talked about. This is what the people who believe it subscribe to. This is what they value. Provincialism. Amateurism. Authenticity. The spontaneous. The candid. I speak the truth. Traditional. Populist. The idea that those who promote the anti-government sentiment are spokesmen for the people. They are representing the interests of the people. They're speaking from their gut. The word that the president uses all the time, telling it like it is. We're authentic. We're not professional politicians. We're not scholars. We're not experts. You can't trust the experts. You can't trust the pros. You can't trust the establishment. You've got to trust your gut. You've got to trust what comes naturally. Remember Jefferson's letter to his nephew. If you seek the truth and you speak to a professor and a husbandman, a farmer, which one are you most likely to find speaking the truth? Jefferson's argument is the farmer, the man who works and digs in the ground. Because what the farmer says to you is going to be from his gut, what he really means, what he really believes. It's going to be closer to the truth than what you're going to get from the professor, from the professional, from the trained, from people who have become skilled, who have learned the skills of manipulation and rhetoric. They've learned how to persuade you to believe things that aren't true. Fake news. It's only from people you can trust. People that have your best interests in mind, who speak for you, who tell it like it really is, who speak from the gut. They're not your establishment. They're provincials. They aren't from the big cities. They aren't cosmopolitan. They're rural. They're from Middle America. They're from the red states. These are the provincials. These are the people who are real. They're amateurs. They're authentic. They're spontaneous. You can believe what they say because what they say is spontaneous. It's not manufactured. It's not manipulated. It's not designed for PR. It's straightforward truth, speaking the way it really is. Other words to define these values of anti-governmentalism: candid, homogeneous. We're all in this together. We're all one big family. You can trust me to be your spokesman. Just believe what I say and do what I say. And when I tell you somebody is an enemy and you can't trust them, believe me. We're in this together. We're homogeneous. We're all one people. We want the same things. Traditional, populist, organic. In other words, we're all part of something big. We're all brothers, as it were. Our emphasis is on rights. We're human beings. We have certain rights. We're entitled to freedom. Religious freedom. We tend to be very religious people. We're Christians. We're godlike. We respect and worship God. We're honest. We're trustworthy. We say it like it is. We speak from the gut. We're not manipulated. We're not trained experts in untruths, in fake news. We're involved in participating. We're not experts. We're not pros. We're not people who are trained to do the same thing over and over again. We don't form unions. We're unskilled. We're raw. We're undeveloped. We're real. All those characteristics. Let me run down Gary Wills' list again. Provincial. Amateur. Authentic. Spontaneous. Candid. Homogeneous. Traditional. Populist. Organic. Rights-oriented. Religious. Voluntary. We're in this because we want to be in it, because we choose to be in it, because it's the right thing to do. What I say is truth, is what's right. Participatory. We're all in this together. These are the characteristics of the values of anti-governmentalism. People who believe these things, who are these things, the real, the authentic, the untrained, the amateur, the provincial, the candid, the spontaneous, the traditional, the populist, the people. We are the people. And I speak for the people. What are the one thing all of us have in common? Everything we are is threatened by government. When government can function, when government has a budget big enough to create agencies and programs that get into our pocketbooks, into our living rooms, into our bedrooms, they threaten our very freedom to live the way we choose to live, the way that is natural. In other words, the biggest threat to everything we believe in is government. That's the history of this nation as Gary Wills addresses it in his book, A Necessary Evil. Where does this title come from? Obviously, it comes from the belief as expounded by people like Jefferson, who believed that that government governs best which governs least, or as Thoreau says, which governs not at all, because it maximizes people's freedom. the less able it is to govern, the freer people are. That's the myth of anti-governmentalism. That's the myth that the administration seeks to promote. That's the myth associated with calling your opponents a mob. Because while we say, I am one of the people, that's very positive. That gives you a good feeling, a sense of belonging, a sense that you're with other people who believe and think the same way you do. But when people you trust, like the President of the United States, tells you that those who don't subscribe to what you do are part of a mob, that's a bad feeling. That makes you uncomfortable. That makes you insecure. That makes you feel somewhat threatened. That's something we need to do something about. An example of this, I'm going to give you one example because we don't have that much time. But this is really the first chapter that Gary Wills deals with. Is the myth that comes out of the period of independence, out of the American Revolution. It's the idea of the Minutemen. The idea that American independence was won not by a standing army, not by a trained military, but by the average guy doing what he believed in, fighting for his freedom. The image we are all given in our textbooks, the image that is painted for us over and over again, are the British redcoats marching to Concord and Lexington to arrest the people who are leading the movement for American independence. They're out to arrest Sam Adams and John Adams and John Hancock, the leaders of the movement, the leaders of the people, and they are a trained military, a standing army, and the reason the mother country sent them here is to imprison us, to threaten our freedom, to take away our freedom. And because of that we have a right to fight back. So what is the image that we have of the regulars, the British regulars marching Concord and Lexington, and the Minutemen taking up arms and shooting and picking off the British regulars from behind trees and driving them back to Boston in a massive retreat? The people beating the system, the real people fighting the establishment, the Minutemen, the heroes of our independence, and their reliance on weapons. The fact that the biggest threat to people's freedom during this period was a standing army, was a trained military being used by government to enslave its people. And American independence is the good guys fighting back. That's the myth That's the sense of anti-government sentiment. The idea that when government can do that, it threatens people's freedom. And it sends trained military over here to do it. But it's the little guy. People who's fighting for their freedom. Unpaid, voluntary. Real, honest, down and true people. Taking their muskets from above their mantle. Going out behind trees and fighting back. That's the origin of the anti-government myth that Gary Wills uses to open his book. That's the first part of his first chapter. Why is it a myth? Well, because the research tells us that most of the citizens didn't own guns. That this idea of individual citizens bearing arms to protect their own freedom from a government that threatens it is a myth. Who would perpetrate that myth? The NRA. Who does the NRA stand for? Armed individual citizens who have a right to bear arms under our Bill of Rights, under our Constitution? Turns out that the NRA represents the gun manufacturers, those who seek to sell guns. And if you're going to sell guns on a massive scale, people need to want them. And the way you get people to want them is to convince them they have to have them to protect themselves from their own government. There's all sorts of evidence that Gary Wills introduces in his first chapter that indicates, contrary to what we believe, that not many of these so-called Minutemen were armed. There were stories. Let me share some of it with you. I have a moment. I think I do. I think I have about... No, I don't. I guess we'll have to pick this up tomorrow. But this is one of the stories, one of the quotes, is a whole group of volunteers show up in Boston to help the citizens of Boston repel the British from New Hampshire. A whole group of New Hampshire militia come to Boston to help in the defense of Boston. Fewer than half of them have weapons. What they have is togetherness. What they have is numbers. But they all don't have weapons. But history tells us they did. And history tells us that the only way that people can protect their own freedom from a government that seeks to take it away is to be armed. And there lies the origin of the myth of the Minutemen. We'll be back to this. This is fascinating stuff. I hope you agree. If you do or if you don't, and you have something to contribute one way or the other, I would love to hear from you. So please take it upon yourself to make that happen. We're at the end of our program. We've reached the top of the hour right now. It is exactly 3 p.m. in the East. Let me thank you for the opportunity to be with you today. and to get into some of this stuff with you. I think it's fascinating. I hope that you agree. With luck, if everything goes well, we'll be back together tomorrow. And we'll continue this theme, this story, because I think it's very important. Until then, I want to thank you for your continued support of the Head On Radio Network, of Bob Kincaid and Agnes and those folks, and of me and this program, the Virtual Center. I hope you have a wonderful evening. Enjoy yourself. Make sure that you give the hug to the people closest to you that would really make them feel good and thereby make you feel good. I think we're living in a world where we kind of need more hugs, all of us. Again, everything breaks the way it should. We'll see you again tomorrow, same time. This is Bill O'Brien thanking you so very, very much. Have a wonderful evening. Thank you.